Mom!
I got it. What are you doing in there?
I got stuck!
Oh. Are you a dog?
I wouldn't do that. Have you seen the pliers? Where'd you find those?
It's not your birthday.
Sorry.
What are you looking for?
Well, hello there, and welcome to The Pit Stop. I'm your host, Dr. Billy Boyd Cox, and I'm excited to share this time with you on today. Looking forward to what the Lord will share with us. Welcome again to The Pit Stop, and The Pit Stop is the place of power, influence, and transformation. If you've ever been to a racetrack, or if you've ever watched the races, Indy 500, or any of those races on television, and you saw the cars go around the racetrack, and they would make so many laps around the track, and then they would have to pull in to what is called, or what is known as, they would have to make a pit stop. At the pit stop is the place where things are changed, where things are removed, and new things are put in place, where the brakes are taken off, and new brake pads are put on, and oil it's changed. It's the place of transformation. It's the place of change. And here we are today at the pit stop, the place of power, influence, and transformation, looking to God for a change in our lives. So welcome again to the pit stop. I am over excited about our time together today and look forward to sharing with you what the Lord has shared with me. I hope you've enjoyed all of our other sessions, all of our other episodes, particularly the last four where I taught on fresh faith. And I mentioned in the last time, in our last episode, that I was going to talk to you from Ephesians and talk about the full armor of God. And so here we are at that place. And as we prepare our hearts and our minds to hear from God today, let's go before the throne and pray. Father, we thank you, God, for this day. We bless you, honor you, trust you, praise you, God, when we come and delight ourselves in you today, God. We want to hear from you, Lord. We want to know what you want us to know, God, because you have a plan for us. You have an expected end for us, God. You already have everything mapped out, God. We don't have to worry about anything, God. All we have to do is seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else that we need will be added unto us, God. And you tell us to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, all of our strength, all of our might, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, God. We thank you, Lord God, that you command us to love even our neighbors. You command us to love our enemies, Lord God. We don't have to like them, but we love them, Lord God, because you are love and we are your children, God, and we have your DNA in us. And so we thank you today for bringing us to this place where we will know about the full armor of God. We bless you. We love you. We trust and honor you, and we delight ourselves in you. God, I pray for every listener, God. I pray for those who will hear the word today, who will hear the word in the coming days. I pray, God, that it will meet all of us at the point of need. We bless your name today. In Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Again, welcome to the Pit Stop. And if you are listening today or whenever you listen to this broadcast, I pray that you will invite somebody else to join us on Tuesdays at 4 p.m. Join us on Tuesdays at 4 p.m. So that you can hear the live broadcast and share it with someone else. You know, in the time that we're in now where a lot of things are done virtually, radio has been virtual forever. It's always been in the airwaves. And so share this with someone who may not be able to get out and go to a church. Share this broadcast. This is us virtually evangelizing, virtually sharing the word of God with someone else who needs to hear the word. So thank you so, so much for being on here. And thank you so much for sharing the word. Thank you so much for helping me to evangelize, to reach those who want to know Jesus, who need to know Jesus, who deserves to know Jesus, because he is worthy of being known. Thank you again for joining me on today. So let's jump right into our lesson. Ephesians chapter 6. I'm going to begin at verse number 10. And I've been reading and studying this particular text, and I'm not sure that this is going to be one all-inclusive lesson or if I'll need to break it up into multiple lessons. So let's just see and be led by Holy Spirit on today as we go through our time together. Looking at Ephesians chapter 6, beginning at verse number 10. Verse number 10 says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." He says, "Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, and above all things taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplications for all saints." And so I want to pause right there. I'm just going to stop right there. And I've read to you Ephesians 6, verse 10 through 18. And I want to talk about what it looks like to have a dress code. This is a kingdom dress code. This is what we have to put on every single day. You know, if you were in a private school, there are certain dress codes that you have to wear. You can't wear your jeans hanging down. And if you're in private school, in some public schools, you're not even able to wear jeans to school. Or in your work environment, there's a culture there that is set in place. There's a culture there. And some cultures are more relaxed than the others. Some require suits and dresses and heels and pantyhose and ties and the whole workup. Some cultures require that. Some cultures are business casual, where you can come in khakis and shirts, and you can wear skirts or slacks or whatever it is that suits your fancy, as long as it is business appropriate. And in the kingdom, while we don't have to worry about our physical attire, because he wants us to come to him as we are, so we don't have to have suits and hats and gloves and ties and handkerchiefs and all of that other stuff that we want. We think about church, that we think that that's what church is, but no, church is on the inside of the people. We just go to a building, and even in the building, there's a culture there. And sometimes that culture is the thing that handicaps God's people, because you'll find people who will say, "Well, I can't go to church because I don't have anything to wear." Because we have set up that expectation that you have to look a certain way to come into the house of God. And so therefore, a person who is homeless and who sleeps on the street, or a person who has some kind of alcohol or drug addiction, or a person who is just lost and weary one day, and they find themselves just walking back and forth and trying to decide whether they can go into the church or not, or if there's anything inside those doors that is worthy of them even coming in off the street. And then they happen to look down at their shoes and see that they're tattered and torn, or they look at their clothes and they realize, "I've been sleeping in these for 3 days. I probably don't smell fresh." And they know that once they enter in the doors of the church, that there's a possibility possibility, a strong possibility, that they're going to be judged by what they have on and not what's in their heart, that the people are not going to see their hearts. The people are not going to see the need that they have to be inside the house of God. They're going to look at them side-eyed. They're going to look at them strange, and they won't get the benefit of getting to know this person who has just come in because they needed to hear from the Lord, or they needed to see Jesus. And I'm just grateful that that is not a requirement. What clothes we wear is not a requirement for God. He doesn't say, get dressed up, go buy this so that you can come and see me. He wants us to come to him as little children, just like we are. Children don't worry about what they're going to wear to church. They wear whatever we put on them to church. They may say, oh, I don't want to wear that, I want to wear this. But it's not because they're going to church, it's because they just don't want to wear it. But here in the text tells us that there is a dress code, and we don't have to have this dress code for church. It's an everyday living dress code. It is how we need to function in order for us to be able to stand against the things that we are going to face. It is what we must put on when we put our feet on the floor in the morning, even when we sit up on the side of the bed or the chair, wherever you sleep at, wherever you rest at. Even when you set up and you open your eyes, it's incumbent upon us to say, God, help me to put on the full armor today, because I want to be able to face anything that comes against me today. I know that there's some battles that are not my battles to fight, and I trust you, God, in all things. I want to wear your full armor today, God. I want to have on your full armor. I want to be protected today, God. I want to have what's necessary today, God. And so here the Bible tells us, as the Apostle Paul is talking to the church at Ephesus, he's talking to the Ephesians. He says to them, he says, finally, my brethren, meaning brothers and sisters, because God is no respecter of person. But here the text says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So he's telling them, he's giving them a word of encouragement to say, be strong in the Lord. Put your hope in God and everything else will work out. Be strong in him and in the power of his might, because he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you could think or ask, according to the power that works in you. And what is that power? It is a power of the Holy Spirit. It is a power of the Holy Spirit. So he's saying, be strong in the Lord. Let your faith in God be stronger than anything else. Let your faith in God overcome your fears. Let your faith in God cancel out your doubt. Let your faith in God cause you to be made whole. Let your faith in God cause you to be healed. Let your faith in God cause you to be emotionally sound and strong. Let your faith in God be strong. And then he says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, because nothing, no matter how large, no matter how small, can come against God. There is nothing that can take God by surprise. There is nothing that God is not capable and able to handle on our behalf. God doesn't even have to move. He can just send his angels. In the book of Genesis, there's a young woman there by the name of Hagar, and Hagar was the handmaiden to Sarah and Abraham. And when Sarah decided she wanted to help God out because she wasn't getting pregnant and God had promised Abraham that he was going to be the father of many nations, she sent Hagar in to become the concubine, or the second wife to her husband, so that she could get children by him. And so after Hagar had a child, then things got hot in the house, because ladies, I know that there's some ladies listening, you know how it is, there can't be too many grown women in one house. And so things got a little testy, a little tense in the house, and Hagar wanted her gone. And Abram said to her, do whatever you want to do with her. And so she threw her out. She was harsh with her, and she threw her out. And this happened a couple of times, and she found herself out in the wilderness. It was in the wilderness that God spoke to her. from heaven. God sent an angel to her. But then the next time he spoke to her from heaven, and then he sent an angel. He didn't even leave. He sent an angel to minister to her, to let her know that he saw her exactly where she was. And so there is nothing that we can face that God is not already aware of. God can handle all of our stuff. He gives us free will, and we're able to go and make choices and make changes and do what it is we want to do. But when we want it to be done right, there is a standard of operation. There's a way that we have to, that we should approach God. There's a way that God has set in place for us. He says he knows the very hairs on our head. They're all numbered. God knows how many hairs we have on our head. He knows exactly when they're going to fall. God knows what's going to happen this evening. God knows what's going to happen tonight. God knows what's going to happen right now. And we say, okay, on my agenda, I have a Zoom meeting set up for 7 o'clock. On my agenda, I have this going on. On my agenda, I have that going on. But God only knows whether those things are going to take place. So it's easy for us to think about this thing and say, here, let me encourage myself. I don't know what's going to happen today. But God already knows. Early this morning, even before 7 o'clock, the Spirit had laid a person's name in my heart, and so I sent her a text message and just said, "Hey, thinking about you and praying for you this morning. Hope all is well." She immediately responded to me, "Oh my God, you don't know how much I needed this. You don't know how much I needed this." And my prayer was to God, "God, let me be a vessel you use today. God, let me, wherever I have to go and whatever I have to do, wherever I am, use me today." And God wanted her to know that he knows that she's going through. And so he sent a word through me. I had no idea that she really needed prayer. She just popped in my spirit. And that's what it means. That's what it means when it says, you know, and be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, because he knows everything about us. He knows what we need, when we need it, who to send it through. He knows everything. And then verse number 11 says, put on, after you've encouraged yourself to be strong in the Lord and the power of his might, then you want to put on the whole armor of God. Why do we put on the whole armor of God? That we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Because the devil is never off his job. The devil is busy all day, every single day, and he is not alone. He has imps with him. The Lord has angels. The devil has imps. He has workers, and he is never off his post. They never stop working. They never stop working. If they leave you alone for a second, they're only trying to figure out how to come back to you on another side. And they have to go to God. The devil has to go to God to get permission. In the book of Job, Satan had to go to God. God was having, I'll call it a staff meeting. And Satan showed up because he wanted to have access to Job. And God gave him access to Job. He said, but you can't take his life. You can have everything, access to everything that he has, but you can't take his life. And so we have to put on the full armor of God, that when the devil comes up against us, that we're able to stand, even in our weakest moment, that we are able to stand, that we are able to take a stand. That we are able to stand because we are fully equipped. Though we may not have to fight in the battle, we also don't have to fall because we're not aware that, and we're not properly dressed. Our dress code, our spiritual dress code, is important. Here's why it's important. In verse number 12, it says, verse number 11 says, put on the whole armor of God. And you can't put on what you don't understand. You can't put on what you don't know about. You can put it on and then not understand why you have it on. And it doesn't, we're going to walk through this. I sense that I need to take time and just kind of walk through this. So over the next couple of weeks or so, we're going to walk through this as a series. We'll walk through this as a series because I don't want to just gloss through it and run through it, because I can name for you what what the essential elements of the armor are, but we also need to understand why we wear each one of them. Here in verse number 11, it says, put on the whole armor of God. That means we need every piece of it. We're not equipped to face the devil if we just have on one thing and not the other things. We need every piece of it. It's like in the military, nobody goes out to war and leaves their weapons behind. Nobody goes out to war and leave their guns or leave their helmets. Nobody goes out to war and leave the essential tools that are necessary for them to be successful in the battle. Nobody leaves all the good stuff at home. You don't leave the canteen with the water. You don't leave your helmets. You don't leave your gear. You don't leave your combat boots. You don't leave that kind of stuff at home. And as people of God, we can't afford to walk around in a world that is full of spiritual wickedness in high places. We cannot walk around in the world and pretend that we have it going on, and because we have on one piece of the armor. It says put on the whole armor. And that's a critical aspect right there, is that we put on the entire outfit, that we have everything on, because everything is necessary. Were everything not necessary, God would have just said, put on the helmet of salvation. But no, every piece, every artifact, every piece of it is critical for us to be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, because the devil has many tricks. We have to have on every single piece of the armor. Why do we need it on? Because verse number 12 helps us to understand. Because we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We need on the armor, the whole armor of God, so that we'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, because the devil has many, many tricks up his sleeves. And the devil knows us, and the devil knows scripture, and the devil is not afraid to use scripture against us, because sometimes we're these Bible-toting, scripture-quoting people that don't have any power with us, because we have words coming out of our mouths, but we're not functioning under the anointing and the operation of the Holy Spirit. And we need to make sure that Holy Spirit is alive and active in us. We're not prepared to fight any battle without Holy Spirit's help. Even with the armor on, you still got to have the help of Holy Spirit, because there are some things going on that we need spiritual eyes and we need spiritual ears to hear. We need discernment. We need wisdom. We need the morsels. We need the feeding, the food of God, in order to help us understand what's going on around us. And having the armor on and having the Spirit in us helps us to be able to understand that. And this is a tenet of emotional intelligence. And I've talked about emotional intelligence before, and at some point I'll teach about it. I don't want to make a promise right now, but I want to show you here, because sometimes we get caught up in arguments, we get caught up in discord, we get caught up in disappointments and disagreement, because we are not practicing emotional intelligence. And one of the first tenets of emotional intelligence is self-awareness. So here in verse number 12, reading from Ephesians 6, started at verse 10 and now I'm at verse number 12, says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Sometimes we're mad with people in our family, we're mad with co-workers, we're mad with people in the church, and we're mad with the flesh and blood. But the Bible tells us that that's not what we wrestle with, because it is a spirit that is happening on the inside of them, and it's not always Holy Spirit. There are some other spirits that are roaming around. There are some other spirits, here the text tells us, but we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We don't hate on people. We hate the sins that people do. We hate some of the activities that people do, but we don't hate the people of God, because the Bible tells us in John 3:16 that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever should believe in him would not perish but would have everlasting life. What did I just say? God so loved the world, everybody, the world. He created all of us, and he loves all of us, and he sacrificed Jesus so that we would have an opportunity to reconcile and to come back to him, so that he could be our Father and we would recognize him as our Father. And so here in the text it says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So the people that you are hating on, the people that you are mad with, be mad at the actions and the activity, but not at the people, because we are required to love the people. We're required. It's a commandment to love your neighbor as yourself. And you was like, I love my neighbor. No, your neighbor is whoever you encounter. It's not who lives next door to you. Though that's how the world has defined us as neighbors when we live next door to one another. But your neighbor is whoever you encounter today. Whether you are walking, you're sitting in a doctor's office, you're in the grocery store, you're at the gym working out, wherever you find yourself today, in the courtroom, in jail, wherever you are, there you have a neighbor there. You have a neighbor there. And so we don't wrestle against people. We wrestle against spiritual wickedness in high places. He says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. What did that text just say? It said there's always some evil going on in the world. There's always something deceptive, something heinous. There's always something going on. There is peace, there is good in the world, but there's also evil in the world. And the evil fights against the good at all times. It may not be happening in your house right now. It may be happening across the street. It may be happening on your job. It may be happening to somebody on your job. Evil never ceases. Evil never ceases. I thank God that Jesus has victory over death, hell, and the grave. Jesus has already gotten the victory. But we have to make sure that while we are yet alive, that we are doing our part, that we're doing our parts, and that we are protecting ourselves. There is gear here. There's armor. There's a spiritual dress code that we must abide by. And putting on this whole armor of God protects us, and it helps us to be mindful. And one of the things that I want to encourage you to do is before your feet hit the floor in the morning, ask Holy Spirit to help you put on the full armor of God, that you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, because you are going to encounter something. None of us go through every single day where life is a bed of roses. None of us go through every single day where we don't bump heads with somebody about something. None of us do that. Life isn't perfect like that. When we see God face to face, that will be the day. But these days right here, we are subject to encounter some things that rub us the wrong way. And when they rub us the wrong way, we have to remember that we have on the full armor of God, that we are protected, that we have Holy Spirit living inside of us, and that we are strong in the Lord and the power of His might, that we don't have to flex our muscles because God is flexing His muscles on our behalf. So when we run, when we bump heads with people, use that sense of emotional intelligence, that sense of self-awareness, that you know where you are, you know whose you are, and you know to whom you belong, and you know what you stand for, and that you are fully equipped because you have on the full armor of God. You have everything you need at your disposal. You are fully clothed. There's no part of you. There is no part of you. Well, there is a part. Your back. There is no armor unless you look at the breastplate and how it is gathered behind you, how it's gathered in front of you and connected behind you. But here's what I love, because even the back is covered, because the Bible tells us in the 23rd Psalm that goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And that is our covering. That is our covering. It is not mentioned here as a part of the armor, but it is our covering. And we need to make sure that we are fully covered, that we have on the whole armor of God, that we are able to take a stand when we need to take a stand, that we are not out here in these streets naked, that we are not out here in these evil streets naked, that we are not out here without the full armor of God on our bodies, our spiritual clothing, our spiritual attire that goes underneath and on top of what we will normally put on, our natural clothes, that we are covered even more so. I like watching Batman because I like his car. I like his car. You know how you get in that car and it just seals all around him? That's what it looks like to have on the full armor of God, is that all the pieces, the doors, the windows, the windshields, the lights, how the shield comes down to cover the lights on the headlights on the car, all the pieces just come in and they cocoon around him and shelter him and protect him from whatever the enemy will throw after him. And this is what the full armor of God does for us. It protects us, it shields us, it cocoons us, it surrounds us and protects us from the darts, from the fiery darts of the enemy, from whatever the principalities are, from the powers, from the rulers of darkness of this world, from the spiritual wickedness in high places. We are protected. God has covered us. Thank you so much for being with me today. Put on the full armor of God so that you're able to stand against the wiles of the enemy. Looking forward to sharing with you again on next Tuesday. Find me on social media at Billy Boyd Cox, B-I-L-L-I-E. B-O-Y-D-C-O-X. Find me on social media. You can find me on Facebook by my name. You can also find me on Instagram at Dr. Billy Boyd Cox. At Dr. Billy Boyd Cox on Instagram. I don't tweet much, but you can find me on Instagram. You can find me on Facebook by my name. I look forward to sharing with you. I pray that you were blessed by the word on today. Go in the peace and the power and the strength of the Lord. Put on your real clothes today, because those other clothes can catch fire. They can get stains on them. But when you put on the whole armor of God, you are fully equipped and you are able to face whatever comes up against you, knowing that the Lord is with you. So go in the peace and the power and the strength of the Lord, knowing that God has already gone before you. God bless. And until next time, this has been The Pit Stop, and I'm your host, Dr. Billy Boyd Cox. Take good care. Well, hello there, and welcome to The Pit Stop.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Never gonna let you go. Never gonna let
you. All right. I'm in the house.
Okay, what do you see?
Nothing yet. Hold on. I think I just heard something. I'm heading upstairs.
Okay, I am almost there.
I'm in the bedroom.
Okay.
Oh, shit. It's not here.
What?
The gun's not here.
What? What do you mean? Where is it?
Cam! Cameron? Are you in there? Open the door! Cam! Come on, Cam! Cameron! All right.